Margaret.
Hello, are you all right?
We're having tea.
Hi, Kate. Oh, hi!
Are you primarily a violinist, or do you you play guitar as well?
Yeah, I play guitar as well. So at the moment, oddly, I'm spending a lot more time, a lot more stage time playing guitar than fiddle, because I've been doing a solo thing since 2016, and also actually with my band as well, I play more guitar. But I think of myself primarily as a fiddle player, so it is a bit incongruous at the moment. But I do sing with the fiddle, but it's quite an intense sound.
It's awfully near your mouth, isn't it, too?
Yeah, and it's also very near my register. You know, the fiddle is so close to the tenor register that it's quite a harsh noise, I think, and it's quite an exciting noise. But I've never tried to do a whole gig just fiddle singing. But I suspect it would be a bit wearing for the audience. But it's also quite stressful as a performer, actually, I've realised. Not so much when you've got another musician with you. So playing. So the thing I started off with and I'm about to sort of go back to a bit is playing with John Spires, who's a melodeon player, and that's all fiddle singing. But having a melodeon sort of support you means that it's a perfectly sort of comfortable, natural thing to do.
My love's a window. One night I cried so shrilly, 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 shrilly dee. My love, she arose and put on her clothes. Come down and let me in.
Yeah, so I don't know where he got his version from, but it sounds to me like it's a sort of oral tradition stage on from that version that Andy Turner is singing there. So
it's quite a tricky rhythm.
Well, it's a sort of arrhythmical piece, as are many folk songs, and what you find when you're arranging for band. I mean, if you listen to any of Bellahead's arrangements, they're in very strange time signatures, or combinations of time signatures, and that's often me going. For example, a shanty like Roll Alabama, which is one that I do with Bellahead. So that's often sung, when the Alabama's keel was laid, Roll Alabama, roll. So it's kind of got no fixed pulse. And then when you try and put that into a meter, if you go, when the Alabama's keel was laid, Roll Alabama, roll, she was, right, it loses everything. It loses all the drama. So with that version, we ended up going, when the Alabama's keel was laid, Roll Alabama, roll, she was laid. You know, so you end up syncopating across the beat, which is quite fun. So you end up sort of slightly imitating that arrhythmical feel that it comes from. But yeah, so...
Can I just ask you about all the ornamentation that, you know, when you decide to ornament notes and so on? I mean, can you use those for emotional input, or do you use them like you did just then? It seemed to me you use them rhythmically just then to sort of get the rhythm under your belt when you were singing that last thing.
Ornamentation is quite a big part of it all, and it depends a little bit on what culture you're sort of basing it on. The Irish approach is very non-rhythmical, So the Shronos tradition, which I don't know an awful lot about, but I have been told off my ornaments by Irish. I used to live in an Irish pub, so I used to hang out a lot with Irish singers, and I'd periodically get told off for ornamenting in a rhythmical manner. So which because you really don't do that in Irish singing, and I said yes, but I'm not trying to do that. Thanks very much. But yeah, so but you can do both. And the Irish thing is odd. They tend to close up a little bit to ornaments, so they would tend to go asylum to mine love's window last night, that sort of thing.
It's
So
like a
they
drone.
Yeah, but it's sort of shutting down the mouth a little bit. I don't know. It's a stylistic thing. It's a lovely thing when it's done well. But whereas English singers tend to, and the other thing is that Irish ornamentation tends to come after the note, after the word or the note has been sort of stated. So you tend to go asylum, my. You would start without the ornament, and then you add the ornament sort of later on. Whereas in English style, it tends to be more like, "Where I looked under my love's window," you tend to get it in there a bit earlier, so it does tend to be more rhythmical, and it does work in a more like a song like I don't know. Oh, for me grog, for me jolly, jolly grog. Oh, for me beer and tobacco. You can use it quite effectively in rhythmical songs as a sort of extra catch at the beginning of a note. So yeah, but I guess a lot of the art of folk singing is about ornamentation and when to use it and when not to use it as well,
So when you start, I'm sorry, I'm hogging it. But when you start singing something, do you always sing it with the same ornamentation, or do you find you vary it?
Well, the ideal is to not
Of course.
stick to the same thing. So one criticism I've heard of other people, has been, I think, when I was younger and people felt able to criticize me. It's one of the nice things of getting older. People don't seem to criticize as much. Yeah, I mean, I certainly remember being told that I shouldn't always ornament in the same place. And I think that is a good, in terms of if you're doing a nine verse ballad or something, if you always ornament the C sharp in the second line, it kind of defeats the object of the ornamentation, which is to, it's to keep it interesting, it's to emphasize certain points in the story as well as in the melody. So yeah, so you do try and vary it, and I think some people would go through a whole song and actually work out which bits they're going to ornament, which they're not. I never do that. I just sort of kind of muck about, and you have to be a little bit careful not to get, once you've been singing something a long time, not to kind of fall into lazy patterns with it. So you do have to kind of monitor yourself a little bit. But yeah,
Thank you.
so do you want to learn a little bit? So no, I'm sorry, the other thing I was going to say is you probably noticed I was singing the wrong words quite a lot. And that's partly because I don't sing this one very much, but it's also I think it's part of the process of the folk singer, is that you don't adhere to the source, religiously, because it, so which I think is unusual. I think certainly classical music, the idea of that you might change the lyrics or change the melody is very unusual. But it's almost like it's kind of the thing when you're trying to make a song your own, that you, if there's a lyric you're not that fond of, you might just swap it out, or if there's a little melodic quirk that you think helps the tune, you might put it in. And you don't want to sort of do it for the sake of doing it, but you also don't want to, you don't want to not do it, for the sake of not doing it. If you know what I mean. So you know, and I think the lyrics and those little repetitions that you heard Lou Killen sing there, I'm not mad keen on. I'm going to play a bit more of Lou Killen now.
Love's jars. My heart beats a faint, so very faint, so very faint.
So there's just those sort of extra, those extra repetitions, which are kind of cool, but I kind of feel a bit weird about. So I'm still finding my way around those as to kind of altering the melody a bit so that I don't get those repetitions. But yeah, so it's still a work in progress. But let's have a go anyway. So. I'll